Hey guys, welcome to the Lorecore Multiverse. If this is your first time here, allow me to welcome you to the channel in a heightened state of being. We find ourselves in the ether, a realm between realms. These are core gates, and each one leads to an entire universe. Many of them are already active, but today we bring the MCU core gate online. I put a post up a short while ago asking what you want me to look at next. Overall consensus was really close, but ultimately, a winner emerged. The option was The Dark Knight or Iron Man. Of course, Iron Man was the next subject you wanted me to cover. The Dark Knight will still get its chance, but today we're giving the Iron Man suit the most detailed breakdown. Just quickly, be sure to follow us on Twitter and jump into our Discord server, and we also have Patreon where you can reap the immense benefits of the multiverse and help support the continued growth of the channel. Links to all are in the description. Today, we will analyze the Iron Man suit from the outermost layer inward, looking at each of the major components as we go. I will reference known lore on the particulars of the Iron Man suit, as well as inferring some information and hypothesizing on other aspects based on what information is available, known principles of science and technology, and my own background and professional qualifications, to see if we can't shed some light on some of the deeper aspects of the suit. I will just clarify here, I will be looking at one particular permutation of the suit, and arguably the first true Iron Man armor. The Mark 1 was a first crude effort, the Mark 2 refined the idea and linearized many of its design principles, but the Mark 3 was the first suit to really see active combat and was the suit that metamorphosized Tony Stark into Iron Man. There will be time for the other suits, so with all that said, let's take an in-depth look at the Mark 3 Iron Man suit. Let's move.
This is how he did it.
This is only a first crude effort. Stark has perfected his design. He has made a masterpiece of death. A man with a dozen of these can rule all of Asia.
The Mark III armor was Tony Stark's third Iron Man suit and an upgrade from the Mark II, improving on its previous flaws. It was the first suit to integrate an advanced onboard weapon system and was the first to adopt the classic red and gold color scheme. It was the first of his new powered exoskeleton designs to actually see combat and masterfully put to work the genius of Tony's mind and the technological innovations and developments that were made out of necessity when held captive by the Ten Rings. And it paved the way for the Mark III and every other major Mark iteration thereafter. It is true of powered exoskeletons both in real life and in the MCU that one of the major limiting factors of their creation is a power source sufficiently small, mobile and power dense to supply the armor with all its energy needs while not inhibiting its mobility. Tony achieved and perfected this with the arc reactor. This is where we begin. The arc reactor is a fusion type power source featuring a palladium core and was the initial power source for the first Iron Man Mark suits and was later modified to an advanced level by Tony to power his more advanced suits as it kept on improving. During the Ten Rings attack and capture of Tony Stark, a bomb exploded near Stark causing shrapnel to enter his body near his heart, threatening his life. Jensen removed most of the shrapnel but some were too close to his heart, so he created a way of stopping the shrapnel by using a powerful electromagnet and a car battery. Stark knew that to stand a better chance of survival, he had to replace the relatively weak car battery. Thus, he adapted the design of the large arc reactor that powered his factory and created a miniaturized reactor that could fit in his hand, giving him a compact and powerful power source that fit directly into his chest and was guaranteed not to fail from normal use. The original arc reactor was capable of generating 3 gigajoules per second. It can keep Tony Stark's heart running for 50 lifetimes, as mentioned by Jensen. Stark responded to that with,
"Or something big for 15 minutes."
The reactor was later replaced by the Mark II model when Tony returned to the US. This arc reactor was significantly more refined and had a much higher energy output potential. Quintessentially, the arc reactor is a nuclear fusion reactor. The palladium core serves as a hydrogen storage medium. Palladium has the property of being able to absorb up to 900 times its own volume of hydrogen, and since hydrogen is the ideal fuel for nuclear fusion reactions, it made sense to have a means to store a reasonable quantity of it for the purposes of fusion. The hydrogen is then drawn from the palladium core and entered into a microscale torus where it is energized upon its first startup, to the point that the hydrogen turns into plasma. The electrons from the atoms disassociate from the nucleus, creating a high-energy ion beam. This is then utilized for beam target fusion, a permutation of colliding beam fusion, whereby the high-energy ion beam collides with hydrogen atoms entered into the torus and continue to induce the fusion and ion disassociation. The flow of ions is then harvested in a process of electrostatic direct energy conversion, thereby converting the ions into usable electricity to power the Iron Man suit and all of its systems. It is worth noting that protons are produced by ionizing the hydrogen, and when high-energy protons collide with other hadrons, it produces a pion, which decays into a muon. Muons appear to be an integral component of repulsor technology, which we will cover shortly, although muons within the reactor also help catalyze fusion at room temperature. After nearly perfecting his Iron Man Mark II armor, Tony Stark discovered a near-fatal icing problem in the suit during a high-altitude test flight, after which he decided to move on to develop the Mark III suit. Stark later solved the suit's icing problem by using a gold-titanium alloy from an earlier satellite design that wasn't prone to freezing. The gold-titanium alloy has a higher yield strength, tensile strength, hardness, and magnetism than either of its constituent metals, and the addition of gold increases the alloy's thermal conductivity to the point that the armor system's waste heat keeps the plate sufficiently warm to avoid the icing problem. The exact permutation of the alloy is called titanium 3 gold. The alloy is created at relatively high temperatures and produces an almost pure crystalline form of the beta version of the alloy. This makes the crystal structure 4 times harder than titanium. At lower temperatures, the atoms tend to arrange in another cubic structure, the alpha form of titanium 3 gold. The alpha structure is about as hard as regular titanium, so it is reasonable to assume that Tony used the beta form of the gold titanium alloy, which gives the plates impressive ballistic properties while still being lightweight versus steel alloys. It is also worth noting that the alloy is biocompatible, meaning that it can be used for medical implants and not react to the body. This would be a desirable attribute for later models of the Iron Man suit, which include nanocomponents, allowing the armor to form directly out of Tony Stark's body. The armor plating is highly articular, allowing comprehensive cover over the body while not inhibiting movement, while at joints and points of movement, the plates can articulate and move and slide over one another, maintaining this significant coverage but not getting in the way of free movement. The light gold finish is as a result of the mix of titanium and gold atoms, and the hot rot red appearance of other plates is a design aesthetic choice made by Tony to inject a little of his own personality into the suit. You'll notice the armor plating of the suit has been designed to smooth the profile of the humanoid figure. The chest is rounded while the back is partially hunched and tapers to a nearly perfectly straight. The legs, when in a straight orientation, feature plates that close together and smooth the aerodynamic flow of air moving over them. This was intentional to try to offset the otherwise poor aerodynamic profile of the human body, while still fulfilling its function as a movable suit of armor. The armor's profile provides a small amount of lift from the lifting body effect, whereby the airflow across the chest and down the body is slower than the flow of air over the back, thereby producing lift. However, on its own, in its default configuration, this is not enough to overcome the force of gravity and drag. The entire armor plate assembly is mounted onto a very sophisticated control surface subassembly for the purposes of sustained flight control. Aircraft flight control surfaces are aerodynamic devices allowing a pilot to adjust and control the aircraft's flight attitude. Development of an effective set of flight control surfaces was a critical advancement in the development of the Iron Man armor due to the desire to include flight systems and a fundamental need to be able to control the suit when the overall shape of the humanoid form isn't particularly aerodynamic. Early effort flight systems for the Mark 1 and Mark 2 succeeded in generating sufficient lift to get Tony and the suit off the ground, but once aloft, the suit proved uncontrollable, often with disastrous results. The development of effective flight controls is what allowed the stable flight. While the armor plates were designed to be smooth, ergonomic, and as aerodynamic as possible, this accounted for very little unless these surfaces can be controlled. This was achieved via integrated microhydraulics. These are visible as an integrated metallic surface accented with hydraulic lines within the surfaces. These were a complex array of small-scale hydraulic actuators identical to standard-sized hydraulic systems and components, but in a smaller scale. True working and functional microhydraulics follow the same operating principles and behavioural properties as their standard or regular-sized hydraulic prototypes, and thus are a broadly known and understood technology. The small scale makes them ideal form factor for such a tight size requirement, and the proportional force able to be generated by them facilitates the function as movement systems behind the control surfaces. With the intermediate hydraulic fluid able to be pressurized up to 10 bar or around 140 psi, this enables the control surfaces to be articulated against the force of moving air present during flight. Bearing in mind that the Iron Man armor is capable of supersonic flight, the flow of supersonic air would be tremendous, and so very powerful control surfaces would be required to maintain flight altitude at these increased speeds. Underneath the armor plating and control surfaces, sharing a common space with the microhydraulics, is the suit's primary support structure. This frame appears to be made of steel, judging by its suggested weight, its gauge, and the fact that it must carry the combined weight of the entire suit of armor. It's multifaceted, hinged, and joined in highly complex arrangements to allow the suit to be assembled and disassembled quickly around Tony, while also being able to match the points of anatomical articulation required of the suit. Since the frame is weight-bearing, it is necessary that when the frame is assembled around the wearer, they lock together in such a fashion as to fully facilitate the weight of the suit above it, being transferred sufficiently through the frame and into the ground. The boots and lower legs are seemingly a cohesive unit that articulates at the toes, ankles, and is rigid then until the knee. The knee joint is bridged by servo motors, where the frame then continues up the thigh to the hip joint. Since the hip joint is quite complex, a series of hinges and servo motors connected sequentially to each other enable full range of motion for the hip joint. The abdominal section is highly complex with many overlapping movement systems, utilizing very small linear actuators to aid in power assist. The helmet is supported on its own support structure, and the arm assemblies connect to the torso via 360-degree rotational hub rings and a hinge assembly to cover the full range of motion of the shoulder. These are power-assisted by geared motors on the hub and linear actuators, respectively. The points of movement, such as the knees, hips, shoulders, elbows, ankles, wrists, and abdominals, are connected together with a series of powerful movement systems that ensure the suit can be moved with little effort, and to maintain its posture so the wearer isn't responsible for holding the weight of the suit up. The actual movement systems appear to be provided by a plethora of different electric motor-based actuators and additional gearing systems. This is evident by the characteristic motorized whine that can be heard when the suit is moving. Given the tight space requirements of the Iron Man suit, the motors and gearing is able to generate an impressive amount of power, as demonstrated in this scene where, for a brief moment, Tony is able to hold the weight of an Audi Q7 2008 4x4 with a gross weight of around 6,328 pounds or 2,870 kilograms, while the suit is operating on a massively reduced power output due to using the older Mark 1 arc reactor chest piece. There are a few ways in which this level of power can be generated by motors, but given the aforementioned space requirements, I'd assume this is achieved by a multi-stage compound epicyclic gear train being powered by an extremely low-profile, high-torque electric motors. Epicyclic gearing, or planetary gearing, is a gear system consisting of one or more outer or planet gears or pinions revolving around a central sun gear or sun wheel. Typically, the planet gears are mounted on a movable arm or carrier, which itself may rotate relative to the sun gear. Epicyclic gear systems also incorporate the use of an outer ring gear or annulus, which meshes with the planet gears. Planetary gears or epicyclic gears are typically classified as a simple or compound planetary gear train. Simple planetary gears have one sun, one ring, one carrier, and one planet set. Compound planetary gears involve one or more of the following three types of structures. Meshed planets, there are at least two or more planets in mesh with each other in each planet train. Stepped planet, there exists a shaft connection between two planets in each planet train. And multi-stage structures, the system contains one or more planet sets. Compared to simple planetary gears, compound planetary gears have the advantage of a larger reduction ratio, higher torque to weight ratio, and more flexible configurations. The relation between the size and tooth count of the Sun, planet, and ring gears, and which are the input and output, are what determines the gear ratio. The Iron Man suit likely uses the Sun gear as the input. The ring gear is held stationary, making the planet carrier the output. This is the highest attainable gear ratio configuration for an epicyclic gear train. I mocked together an idea of what could be the compound planetary gear train used in the Iron Man platform. In this model, the Sun gear in white is the input and the blue annulus is held stationary. The Sun gear drives the red planetary gears, which in turn moves the first stage pink ring gear. On the other side of this, the ring gear is directly connected to another Sun gear, which again rotates red planetary gears. The planetary gears attached to the planet carrier, seen here in green, which is the output. This particular configuration achieves a 100-to-1 gear ratio. This means that the motor at the input would need to rotate 100 times to produce a single rotation. However, since these are meant to be used on the limbs, and the maximum flex of an elbow joint, for example, is around 140 degrees, or a little less than half a rotation, this means the gear system has to be structurally limited to avoid hyperextension of the joint, as evidenced by the mirrored extrusion on both the blue and green components, respectively. These are designed to hit each other and interfere with each other to avoid the gear train from bending any further forward, and interfere with themselves when it bends through to 180 degrees. This also means that the motor need only produce 37 revolutions to produce a full flex of the joint. This also means that the torque input is increased by a ratio of 100 to 1. This means the proportionally high revolution per minute and relatively high torque motors would translate to extremely high torque and just the flex of the given limb. To activate a given joint in the suit, the user input for movement would be detected, translated, and sent to the respective joint and the motor activated. This torque would be input into the center or Sun gear of the multi-stage gear train. The Sun gear would rotate the planet gears. The planet carrier would connect to an armature, which in turn would link to one half of the support structure, while the outer ring gear would link to the other half of the support structure. The multiple rotations of the motor would transmit through the gear train, reducing the output RPM to effectively half a rotation, facilitating the function of a hinge joint of the limb of the user, while also increasing the output torque by the same ratio. These kinds of gear trains would be present across many of the joints of the Iron Man armor, and on top of these, linear actuators appear to be used for smaller joints such as fingers and general abdominal movement. Due to the huge variance in motor power and type, and gear train configuration, ratios and the like, it is nearly impossible to say with any degree of certainty exactly what motors and gear ratios are used within the Iron Man armor. Indeed, even looking at its physical feats and trying to reverse calculate them necessitates that either the motors or the gear trains have to be defined and non-variable. A higher ratio gear train means that a smaller, less powerful motor would be needed, yet a larger, more powerful motor and a lower gear ratio could achieve a similar demonstration of power if they were proportional to each other. So for now at least, I can't say for certain what power the motors are and what the gear trains are configured like exactly. The configurations described earlier were for the purposes of explanation of the relationship between input and output ratios. In order for the wearer's biometric inputs to be detected by the suit and translated into motion, the suit has some integrated Under Armour systems that are likely integrated into the form-fitting undersuit that Tony wears when putting on the suit. There are a few options available in regards to picking up and translating the user's motion. Surface electromyograph, or EMG, assesses muscle function by recording muscle activity from the surface above the muscle on the skin. Surface electrodes are able to provide only a limited assessment of the muscle activity. Surface EMG can be recorded by a pair of electrodes, or by a more complex array of multiple electrodes. More than one electrode is needed because EMG recordings display the potential difference or voltage difference between two separate electrodes. Limitations of this approach are the fact that surface electrode recordings are restricted to superficial muscles. In this regard, the sensor would detect the voltage difference and interpret that as a movement potential. The only issue here is that the system doesn't necessarily detect the speed, force, or degree of movement, so the suit would likely over-respond, requiring overcompensation by the user, which would then be interpreted as another movement to be corrected again. This runaway positive feedback loop would likely make the suit utterly unusable. Some have argued the suit's helmet appears to contain a sensor array that may detect movement impulses from directly within the user's brain. I don't believe this to be particularly likely. Electroencephalography, or EEG, is an electrophysiological monitoring method to record electrical activity within the brain. It is typically non-invasive, with the electrodes placed along the scalp, although invasive electrodes are sometimes used in electrocorticography. EEG measures voltage fluctuations resulting from ionic current within the neurons of the brain. The issue herein is that the EEG requires a huge spectrum of electrodes in order to detect the activity of the brain, and it cannot give the resolution necessary to accurately map the motor potentials from within the brain, independently from the rest of the activity of the brain. There is so much going on inside the brain at any given time that having an array of sensors to solely focus on movement potentials would effectively be picking up all the rest of the brain's activity as noise, which would likely make any attempts at mapping the movement potentials to respective motor systems of the armor impossible. This would only be achievable if Tony had an array of sensors actually embedded within his motor cortex or cerebellum, and even then, it would require extensive surgery to achieve. I personally think that it's much more likely to be a simpler solution. A flex sensor, or bend sensor, is a sensor that measures the amount of deflection or bending. Usually the sensor is stuck to the surface, and resistance of sensor elements is varied by bending the surface. Since the resistance is directly proportional to the amount of bend, the increase of resistance can effectively be monitored to ascertain the desired level of movement. This is a much simpler system and can be more accurately mapped to respective movement systems. Further to this, I believe the suit likely contains some simulations and datasets based on the natural walk, gait, and movement ranges of the human being as a reference point to compare the input it receives from the sensors to the datasets it contains to ascertain the exact combination of movements and motions the user intends. I wouldn't be surprised if Jarvis helps with this process in some regard. It still isn't as cut and dry as this, however, because obviously once the user begins to bend, the suit begins to bend with them, and if the suit bends too fast, then it bends the sensor itself, thereby giving a positive feedback loop, making it think it needs to bend more. So the suit has to be programmed very, very specifically in order to move with the person's body as opposed to slightly ahead of it or slightly behind it. This then allows the suit to move as expected by the user, rather than the user suddenly interpreting drag and having to slow down their motions in respect to the suit, or notice the suit move faster than them, in which case they're trying to catch up, both of which would result in uncontrolled motion caused by overcompensation. Given the level of maneuverability that the Iron Man suit is capable of, the forces at play during flight, and the fact that Tony doesn't appear to lose consciousness through high-G maneuvers, one would assume the suit makes use of inertial dampeners. An inertial dampener is a device that counters or damps the effects of inertia and other forces of motion. The damper does not negate the forces, but simply absorbs or redirects them by another means. It is unclear exactly how the suit achieves this. There is likely a pressure suit or flight suit type system in place, but this wouldn't negate the effects altogether. The inner padding of the suit is mainly for user comfort. It is treated with a liquid silicone spray to keep it waterproof, windproof, and thermally insulating. Its primary function is a comfort layer to provide a moisture-wicking boundary layer between the skin and the outer layer to minimize on risks of dermal abrasions, blisters, sores, and chafing. The suit also appears to contain a biosensor array for monitoring of heart rate, blood pressure and oxygenation, and core body temperature. It also carries environment regulation systems with the ability to cool the user to comfortable levels if the wearer is in a hot environment, as well as warm them in frigid environments. Cooling can be achieved by focusing on the torso and head, as if these are cool, the limbs will cool themselves. However, for heating, it is a different story. A full-body carbon fiber heating matrix is likely the system in play, allowing the heating of the entire body, including fingers and toes, up to around 40 degrees C, ensuring user comfort and mitigation of risks of frostbite. These inner layers likely also have a form of flight suit or G-suit integrated into it. Tony has been seen performing extremely high-G maneuvers without losing consciousness, despite not being a trained pilot. High-G has the effect of pooling blood in the lower extremities. If blood is allowed to pool in the lower body, the brain will be deprived of blood, leading to temporary hypoxia. Hypoxia first causes a greyout or a dimming of vision, followed by tunnel vision and ultimately complete loss of vision, followed by G-induced loss of consciousness. A G-suit does not so much increase the G-threshold, but makes it possible to sustain higher G longer without excessive physical fatigue. The resting G-tolerance of a typical person is anywhere from 3 to 5 G depending on the person. A G-suit will typically add 1 G of tolerance to that limit. Given the amount of G Tony has likely experienced in his flights, it suggests the existence of the aforementioned inertial dampening systems. The Iron Man suit possesses an array of integrated weapon systems that serve to both offensive and defensive purposes. The repulsors on the palms are capable of firing blasts of energy as an effective offensive measure, in addition to providing thrust and stability during flight. As weapons, they appear to have two types of projection: non-lethal, where the repulsor have a milder concussive effect, likely because they're being used on a lower power setting, or the lethal type, which looks like a laser and can crack through concrete. The arc reactor can be overloaded, resulting in a concentrated beam of energy being blasted from the chest piece. The minigun is an included set of miniguns concealed in the shoulders of the suit that could fire a total of 12 shots. Each gun contained 6 shots and was capable of firing at individual targets simultaneously. It is unknown if the guns fire projectiles, then retarget to fire again and so on in a split second, if each barrel is individually targetable, or if the projectiles are guided. The suit contains a small set of anti-tank missiles. These appear to be guided high-explosive missiles, likely with a shaped charge property, as the missile appeared to strike a tank somewhere on the turret. The resulting explosion was likely from the missile detonating, a shaped charge getting into the turret, catching the magazine and causing them to explode as well. The Mark III also contains a set of flares used for defensive countermeasures. The flares are contained in 2 cylindrical drums located on the hips. In addition to the control surfaces across the entirety of the surface of the Iron Man suit, the suit also makes use of Stark Industries' proprietary repulsor technology to enable flight. The repulsors are mounted in the palms of the armor's hands and on the bottom of the boots and draw power directly from Tony's arc reactor. Originally meant as a way to stabilize the armor's flight and provide extra agility, Tony found that by focusing their energy he could create powerful energy blasts to use against his enemies. Remember earlier when I was discussing the arc reactor, I mentioned that muons being integral to the repulsor technology. Well, to recap, protons are produced by ionizing hydrogen. Protons colliding with other hadrons make pions, and pions decay into muons. Muons are very similar to electrons but have approximately 207 times the mass. Muons are channeled into the emitters on the palms, boots or chest, where they gather and are energized by an electric current. This generates a small amount of plasma in the emitter. The suit then takes air through the suit and runs it to any of the emitters. The passage of air through the plasma adds reaction mass and causes a thermal expansion and ionization of some of the gases that pass through the plasma. Because of muons' electromagnetic properties, the plasma and muons can be fired from the pulses by activating a repulsive electromagnetic field to accelerate the plasma and air out of the emitters to create sustained repulsor blasts, resulting in thrust, or much shorter duration, higher intensity blasts, as a primary weapon. The helmet of Iron Man's suit is made of the same material as the rest of the armor. It has a hinged automated faceplate that can be opened and sealed at will. The inner surface of the helmet faceplate features a coherent light laser-based pico-projected augmented slash virtual reality display that overlays various layers of information onto the world around the user, granting them enhanced situational awareness, targeting, analytics, and full access to the suit's enhanced features. While the suit has 2 small visored eye holes, it is likely that these are fronted by prismatic crystalline material that allows imagers and image sensors mounted on the inner surface of the faceplate to see outside of the helmet without directly obstructing the view of the user when the suit's HUD is inactive. These imagers project a stereoscopic corrected view of the surrounding area onto an integrated display over the eyes, giving the impression of a full, unobstructed field of view. This is mediated by an interface that overlays additional information vectors onto the user's field of view with 3 dimensionality based on priority, allowing more immediate and more essential information to appear to be displayed closer to the user with less immediate information being displayed further away. This interface can reactively respond to the suit situation between a passive mode, an active flying mode, and a combat mode. There are likely dozens of other bespoke or specialized modes that can be selected at will, or amalgamations of all of them based on the exact needs of the time. The interface is managed by Stark's personal AI, Jarvis, and thus can be attenuated nearly instantly to new incoming data streams that Jarvis processes and then prioritizes. The helmet also contains a full-spectrum communications device. This includes something similar to a telephone service, as the user is able to make phone calls in the suit. Much like any other phone call, it can be hard to hear during high-noise scenarios such as flight. It can also communicate via encrypted channels to allied forces in the area, as well as through loudspeakers built into the helmet so people nearby can hear the user as well. The suit's built-in auditory systems translate sound detected by the auditory hubs over each ear and use an algorithm to build a 3D sound weave to localize sound so that despite having a helmet over the head, the user can hear and localize sound intuitively. Around the mouth area of the helmet is an oxygen mask. This consists of small vent systems that cycle air as the user breathes and supplements additional oxygen should the oxygen levels drop to dangerous levels. The suit is not entirely hermetically sealed or vacuum rated, making it unsuitable for ultra-high altitude or exo-atmospheric flight. However, this system is implemented on later models. At the time, it seems the viable operational parameters of the Mark III only necessitate a need for supplemental oxygen for high altitude or supersonic operation. The Mark III Iron Man armor, by any measure, is a fantastic and extremely powerful powered exoskeleton system. It is nearly impervious to damage, capable of supersonic flight, impressively armed for such a form-fitting suit, and highly powerful and mobile. When you consider that the suit was prototyped and fielded when the standard gear for even the best outfitted soldiers in the world was still just trauma plates and flak jackets, the Iron Man took quantum leaps forward in personal armor systems as well as flight platforms, energy generation technology, and interface systems. Had these kind of suits fallen into the hands of dangerous individuals, they truly could have enabled a person to dominate any battlefield of the time and seize any assets they desired, with the rest of the world left precious little viable options to counter it at any time. It is thus unsurprising that the arrival of such a suit into the world and the proclamation from Tony Stark that he was the man behind the suit, that the world governments perceived the Iron Man suit as an extremely dangerous weapon and one worthy of intervening action. That being said, with the threats that would ultimately present themselves within the following weeks, months, and years, the Iron Man emerged at an ideal time. While basically being a heavily armored powered exoskeleton is flight capable, the innovations it sports alongside Tony's genius sets it as one of the most dominating forces in the Marvel Universe. Thanks for watching. This was the inaugural video covering the MCU. In the near future, I will cover other prominent Iron Man suits as well as tons of different technology from all across the Marvel Cinematic Universe and give them all a fair crack in the most detailed series. So if you want to see that and more content like this from other universes, be sure to hit that subscribe button and the bell icon so you do not miss a single installment. A quick shout out to my epic patrons, Kenwood and the Accursed. Thanks for your continued support and rest assured content is lined up to come thick and fast. Be sure to follow us on Twitter, link to our Discord is in the description, and if you can, pop over to Patreon and support the channel over there for loads of exclusive perks. It also massively helps me out and keeps things moving forwards towards world domination. I look forward to you joining me on our next dive into the multiverse. Lorecore out.